Welcome, friends and colleagues, wherever you are in the world. We hope that you are well and safe, and thank you for joining us today. My name is Elodie. I am the Executive Director of the World Diamond Council. As you know, the WDC's mandate is to represent the natural diamond and jewelry industry and their position in the Kimberley process, but also to protect the integrity of the supply chain. That is why we decided to hold our first webinar with you, KP family and WDC members, our most important stakeholders. We are here to discuss how the tripartite structure of the KP can take an active role in creating the vital pool that brings profitability to the whole diamond value chain. That same pool that allows proceeds to flow back to the communities in the diamond producing countries. With us today, WDC President Edward Asscher and David Kellie, the CEO of the Natural Diamond Council, the NDC, who will give us insight on how data can help us understand today's consumers' behavior. Before I give the floor to Edward for his opening remarks, I would like to give you a few words on the NDC. 5 years ago, the then Diamond Producers Association was created by the six largest diamond producing companies who came together in order to drive diamond desirability through generic marketing campaigns. Last June, and with now seven members, the organization was renamed the Natural Diamond Council, a strategic change that enhances its objective, driving consumers' desirability for natural diamonds. And this is done by looking at the whole diamond story and impact from mine to retail. If you wish to ask a question to one of our panelists, please use the dedicated Q&A section at the bottom of our screen. We will address as many as possible, time permitting, as we wish to keep this session under an hour. Zoom fatigue is real these days. Let me finish by thanking WDC member Sibjo and its president Gaetano Cavalieri for lending us their webinar platform for this event. And also Stephen Benson, our communication expert, who's handling the technical aspect to provide us with a seamless experience. Without further ado, please, Edward, give us your opening remarks.
Thank you, Elodie. This year is so very different from my first year as president of the World Diamond Council, which was in 2014 and 15. In those early years, we were talking about transparency, accountability, and compliance. At the time, we had to make the industry more aware of the changes of what was expected of all of us. Today, the diamond industry is not only compliant, but we are fully aware of a new era and changing times. We now live in a world where many decisions are forced upon us by the pandemic, and this has influenced every aspect of the business. 2018 and 2019 were not that great for the diamond business, and now we are longing for business activity like we had in those years. But the very essential changes are coming to the surface when we look at research of consumer behavior, especially in these pandemic times. The essence of the research by the NDC, the Natural Diamond Council, is that it tells us what the expectations are of the changing consumers. They know how to talk today to today's consumers, that younger generation that only cares for a product with social significance and no negative impact. Without the NDC, polished diamonds won't sell, but NDC does need our help to do so. We hear too often about violations of our principles in some producing countries, and we need to work together to eradicate these. We cannot lose consumer confidence. This is the prerequisite to the health of the industry, the starting point to bring revenues to producing and manufacturing countries. Without consumer confidence, there is no possibility to ensure a fair share of wealth to the mining communities. We have to face the fact that conflict diamonds are not the only ones that will be forsaken. All the diamond categories will be tainted if we do not come together. If you hear about conflict diamonds and human rights abuses, would you turn to a laboratory grown diamond to celebrate a moment like no other? That is a question we all should be asking ourselves. The realization of change in consumer behavior is paramount. So is the growth of lab-grown diamonds, which may bring profits to retailers. But lab-grown diamonds bring nothing at all to the millions of people in Africa, Russia, or Canada and Australia who make their livelihood with the production of rough natural diamonds. And that is why I commend the KP chair for 2021, the Russian Federation, for putting once again the expansion of the definition on the table for discussions, and also the EU for their willingness to lead this crucial work. The World Diamond Council is also in favor of the joint proposal made by the KP chair 2021 and the KP chair for 2020, or now 2021 and 2022, the Republic of Botswana following the Russian Federation. These are the seven principles of responsible diamond sourcing, as they represent the foundation of what the NDC needs to drive diamond desirability. These seven principles are: 1, complying with internationally accepted standards related to human rights; 2, labor rights; 3, environmental practices; 4, anti-corruption; and 5, anti-money laundering. Principle 6 involves the supporting of the development of communities in the mining and production areas. And finally, Principle 7 covers the disclosing and differentiating between natural and synthetic diamonds. These principles should be the cornerstone of our future work within the Kimberley process. Back to you, Elodie.
Thank you very much, Edward. Now, please, may I turn to you, David, so you can tell us a little bit more about the NDC.
So thank you very much, Elodie. Thank you, Edward. Thank you very much for having me on this webinar. I greatly appreciate the opportunity to share with you and all the World Diamond Council the work that we're doing. If you bear with me just one second while I share my screen. So I thought by giving an introduction to who the Natural Diamond Council is. I recognize some names of participants on the call, but not all. So just a quick introduction as to who we are and what we are and what we do. And then I'll take you through some of the work that we've done already this year and what we currently have going on here. So the Natural Diamond Council was originally formed 5 years ago. It was then called the Diamond Producers Association. I joined the Diamond Producers Association almost a year ago in December, and I took over in my role as chief executive on the 1st of January of this year. So I'm pretty new to this industry, and that has both its strengths and its weaknesses, and I greatly appreciate all the support that I've had personally and that we've had from everyone in this industry. We currently have 6 members, which are the major mining companies, so Alrosa, De Beers, Rio Tinto, Lucara, Petro, Amaroa. We're always looking for new members. Our aim is to be very inclusive as an industry, and we partner with all of the major organizations around the world, the RJC, the WFDB, the World Diamond Council. The first thing I had to do when I joined and came into this industry was to learn all the acronyms of all the major organizations. So I think I'll just about pass my first year test for knowing all of those. We have teams in New York, in Shanghai and Mumbai. We have satellite offices with people in London and Antwerp. So in both the major consumer markets and the major markets where activities are happening in the diamond world, we have a team of people. We're a relatively small group of people. We are we're about 30 people globally. Very, very pleased. We've got a lot of great talent in our teams, and I'll show you some of the work they're doing. But being the size of team that we are, we have to remain very focused, and our mission, which I'll take you through in a moment, is really to drive sales and demand with consumers, and then grow confidence in diamonds. So it's a huge industry, it's a global market, and we are the voice from a consumer perspective, and it's a big responsibility that we take very seriously. When I first came into the industry, I was quickly taken to one side by many people, and all of the challenges and problems of the industry were shared with me. But my response to all of those is that if the consumers buy more diamonds, then 95% of the challenges, the issues that happen in this market go away. And that is why I and the Natural Diamond Council are very, very focused on everything to do with the consumer. And we're seeing some great results so far in, you know, with the limited resources that we've got, but some great results in terms of what we're able to achieve. Our mission in life is really to create emotional dreams for natural diamonds that are exciting and culturally relevant. Put simply, we want to re-establish the diamond dream. The diamond dream that was built for so many years with category marketing, that has had an underinvestment in it over the last 10 to 15 years. That's our role, is we are here to recreate the diamond dreams, to make diamonds culturally relevant for a younger audience. But what's really important is that we support those dreams with the values and social benefits that are inherent in this industry. I'll go through it a little bit more in a minute, but what is so important with any goods, any services at the moment, and particularly luxury goods, the consumer wants to know the social benefits. They want to know the values. They want to know the ethics that they're buying into. They want to justify spending money on themselves, but they want to make sure that money is also contributing positively in the world. And that is really critical. And without that, the diamond dream doesn't exist. We want to advance the integrity of the diamond industry. As I said earlier, we work with all of the major diamond industry bodies to inspire, to educate and protect consumers. It's again, trust is critical as part of our values. And that's what we work with so many bodies on. The consumer has changed. This isn't new. The consumer has been changing for a number of years now. The pandemic has really accelerated that change. And some of the changes are the consumer is going to have a much, much greater respect for nature, for the damage that humans can have on the planet if we don't act in a sustainable way. They want to know that goods and services are purposeful. They want to know that we are ethical. They want to know that our mission is to do good in the world. They want to know that goods have a personal meaning to themselves. And again, I'll talk a bit more about this as we go through it, that what do goods they're buying, what do they add in terms of value to themselves over and above being physical objects? And finally, timelessness. There is, the world goes through phases of being fickle, of being temporary, of being short term. But now we are in a real period of timelessness. They want things that last, that want things that create meaning over a significant period of time. So what we've done so far, it's been a whirlwind year for us. It was always going to be a crazy year for us without layering on top of that the impact of the pandemic. We very quickly came together and said at the start of the year and said we need to relaunch ourselves, we need to create a new identity, we need to be more relevant for a younger female millennial audience. So on the 1st of June, we announced our new brand. That's when we changed from being the Diamond Producers Association to become the Natural Diamond Council. We created all of our new identity. We launched our new website, naturaldiamonds.com, with the mission of being the most authoritative platform for diamonds and diamond jewelry in the world. The world of digital is now very complex. It's in the days of category marketing of 15, 20 years ago. Category marketing was about traditional advertising, and now we have to layer on top of that a strong position on Facebook, on Instagram, LinkedIn, Pinterest, YouTube, in China on WeChat and Weibo, TikTok, Snapchat. There's always new platforms that are coming in. It's very complicated, and we've got to determine how we're going to show up and what impact we can make on all of those platforms. We announced in June our first trend report with a desire to bring together retailers, manufacturers, journalists, editors, writers and influencers to get aligned behind trends in the industry. And we brought together the work of our members into focused and consolidated sustainability pillars, which I'll show you in just a minute, to really make sure that we've got a focus of how we present ourselves to the external audience. Phase two, our phase has happened quite quickly, launched on the 16th of September, and that was the announcement of our first global ambassador. It was the launch of our new advertising campaign. And finally, it was the rollout of our second trend report for the holiday season. So this is what I hope that you're all familiar with. If you're not currently going on to naturaldiamonds.com, then I would really encourage you to go there regularly. We now have the most authoritative content in the world on the world of diamonds. We have the best contributors in the world, the best agencies in the world doing the work here. And it's really the strength of our industry is we have so much wonderful content. There is no other industry in the world that has the content that we do. What we're looking to create is the platforms to allow us to share that content with the end consumer. We cover all different topics. We cover epic diamonds, the stories of diamonds and diamonds of old that tells about the value and how the value is maintained in diamonds. We tell stories about newness, about style and innovation, about Hollywood and pop culture, about love and the connection of diamonds between people and emotions. And also really importantly is Inside the World of Diamonds, which talks all about the social benefits that diamonds bring. What you see here is the global platform, the English language platform. But we also have taken that to China with a mixture of locally developed content and content that is shared from the international platform. It looks beautiful. We're getting huge traffic coming into this platform. Our local team in Shanghai is doing an amazing job with with everything that we're doing in China. And in India, again, India, so much wonderful history and heritage and innovation going on in the world of diamonds, again, that our team in Mumbai is tapping into and sharing with the Indian audience. So what's the impact of all of that? It's not just about the pictures and the words, it's about the impact. You can see here the blue is the actual number of daily visitors coming into our websites. The yellow is where we forecasted it to be by the end of December. And what this means is that we will be, as you can see, we're way ahead of where we forecasted ourselves to be, even though we projected really optimistic forecasts. We are way ahead of those forecasts. And what this means in real terms is that each year, tens of millions of people will be coming into our website to digest and be inspired by the many stories that we're telling. And when you look back over in the first half of this year and also for most of last year, we'll be about 150 times the traffic coming into our websites than we were then. And it just shows the impact that we can make, the reach that we can get if we tell these wonderful stories around diamonds to the right audience in the right voice. The many digital platforms, I won't take you through all of those because it would take a lot longer than I have here today. But you can see here just a snapshot of some of our social media posts. On the right-hand side, those are static posts. And you can see on these, we're getting somewhere between 100 and 200,000 engagements to each of these posts. And at the start of the year, we were close to 500 to 1,000. So again, around 100 times better in engagement. On the left-hand side, you can see videos. And if you can see in the detail, for example, on the left-hand side with the post that we did about the legacy of sustainability, over 350,000 views on that post alone. So significant, significant reach here. The audience that we're reaching with this, with all of our platforms all around the world, now gives us the opportunity to be able to tell the world the amazing work that we do. So a bit more detail around sustainability. As part of our pulling together of our positioning, we brought together our members and really focused our members' SDG goals into three common pledges that between them make up 9 of the USDG goals. So we focus on strengthening communities and the impact that our members have in local communities, and just how important the money coming into communities is for creating infrastructure and employment. Protecting the environment in everything that we do. So looking at everything in terms of how our members work and how everything has the impact on the environment and minimizing that as part of their goals. And finally, promoting gender equality and inclusivity. And being a very, very inclusive industry. And again, I as someone who came to this industry from outside, it was a very nice surprise for me to see the amount of work that we're doing and just how successful we are in all of these pledges. Again, if you go onto our website on naturaldiamonds.com, you'll see a very, very detailed website. We focus on all of our members. You can hover over any of the mining and countries that we're in and where we're in. And it shows examples of exactly what we're doing in each of those areas to reaffirm the work done towards our sustainability pledges. And here is just an example. If you hover over Lucara, here's an example of the work they do in Botswana in terms of communities and protecting the environment. So it's really getting out there with all of the amazing work that is being done in our industry and making sure that that has a voice to the end consumer. We have a lot of work coming up. There's a lot of stories still happening. Women in mining actually happened. I'll show you an example of that in just a moment. But as well as just the reference to what we do, we also tell a lot of these narratives using wherever possible the people in our industry and allowing them to share their voice and the work that they do. This was Women in Mining. Again, we got really great engagement on this on our social media platforms. We had a Facebook Live panel with Melanie Grant. And again, you can just see on the left-hand side, that post there, 275,000 views we got on that post. We get huge engagement on all of this, and it's a credit to our industry, the amazing people that we have, and what we give them is the voice to the consumer to be able to tell those stories. We also did a feature on wildlife and rangers to coincide with World Ranger Day on the 31st of July. And again, all around the world, all of the work that is done to protect wildlife in where all of our mines are is really important. And the consumer loves to hear about this. And it's there were great stories, great narratives, and the beautiful imagery really helped us to get those stories to a broad audience. So that was all phase one. It happened very quickly. Our teams worked incredibly hard in very difficult circumstances to be able to deliver. But some of the learnings we took from phase one is that the consumer still loves diamonds. We just need to talk in the appropriate voice. They love diamonds, but the voice of their mother and their grandparents were spoken to about diamonds. That's all changed. And we have to talk to them in a voice that feels more current and more relevant. And if we do that, they are highly engaged in what we do. My background is predominantly was a long time in the fashion industry. And the engagements that we're getting in our industry are way above what we used to get in the fashion industry. So I can tell you that the engagement is there, the desire for diamonds is there, but we just have to expand the reach and make sure we speak to them in the appropriate voice. Digital communication channels are complicated. They're very fragmented. The good news is you can reach a target audience, but there are lots of different audiences, and our industry has been slow to get familiar with, become experts in the digital world. I think the pandemic has helped to facilitate and accelerate that. Our strength is that a lot of our world is traditional. That's our strength. It's very personal. The relationships are personal. We speak with our retailers, speak with clients with a very close relationship. But that strength is also our weakness, and we need to be much stronger in how we dominate the digital channels. Content is key, and I think we all know that, but the content needs to be inspiring, it needs to be varied, and it needs to be relevant. And also celebrities, a lot of the work that we have done with celebrities so far clearly gets high engagement, and therefore they have strong influence. So all of that, really my conclusion from phase one, which started just 5 months ago, is that we are just at the start of this journey. And it's an inspiring journey to reestablish diamond jewelry as the most desirable luxury in the world. And that's our role as the Natural Diamond Council. And that is what we look to all of you for support from. So then we launched into phase two. Phase two, we launched on September 16th with our new advertising campaign. And it was the first exposure of our new consumer line as Only Natural Diamonds. And what we were looking to do through this campaign is really celebrate diamonds. It's our first campaign. It features our first global ambassador. And for those of you that haven't seen her yet, our new ambassador is Ana de Armas. She's beautiful. She's inspiring. She's very much reflective of this new audience that we're looking to appeal to. She's got huge integrity. She very much wanted to join in the mission that we've set out to achieve. But she didn't take that for granted. She spoke to many people in our industry to understand exactly our values and our ethics. She spoke to many of our amazing women in our industry to validate what we were telling her in terms of our mission to be inclusive, and she's wonderful, and she's best known for her work to date, which she got a Golden Globe nomination for her role in Knives Out. And she will be in the forthcoming, she'll be Paloma, the Bond girl in the forthcoming Bond movie, which keeps being put back because of the pandemic and is now scheduled for April launch. She'll also appear in a biopic of she'll be the lead in the biopic of Marilyn Monroe in the forthcoming Netflix movie, Blonde as well. So she's on the rise, she's a superstar. And the diamonds look amazing on her, and she's just a perfect ambassador for our industry. So what is our story? What are we looking to create through this? Well, our story is really about moments, and a critical insight that inspires us, that differentiates diamonds and diamond jewelry, is that a diamond has a meaning beyond the physical meaning. That whenever she looks at her diamond, it's reflective of a moment, it's reflective of a relationship, it's a reflection of an achievement, it's a reflection of a human connectivity, and that's unique in our industry. She can buy other luxury goods, she can spend $1,000 on a new iPhone, but none of those are going to have that meaning that that a diamond has for her lifetime, and even to pass on to the next generation. So they're about moments that she has experienced in the past. They're looking back and reminding herself. They're also about moments that she has yet to create. They're about what we're going to be, where we're going to be in life, and that whole story of life and how individual it is to her, and what they mean to her as she goes through life's many moments. And the fact that only natural diamonds can create those moments. So with that, in just a moment, I'll remind you of what the campaign looks like before passing back to Elodie and Edward. The campaign has been in the market for just over 4 weeks now. We're getting phenomenal success from it. Interestingly, in China and India, where historically we've run local campaigns created locally, featuring local talent, this campaign has performed hugely successfully. And is getting great engagement. So we're getting a wonderful response from it. This campaign will run through the first half of next year before we look at what we do again in the second half of next year. So with that, I'll remind you of exactly what the campaign looks like.
True connection changes you. It inspires you to dare greatly. To love fearlessly, to soar. Our moments, our stories, they belong to us for moments like no other.
So thank you all, thank you very much for listening. I think we're now gonna do a couple of questions.
Thank you, David. Thank you very much. So you told us about the complexity to drive consumers' desirability for natural diamonds, and also how did NDC concentrate its efforts to make them relevant to today's consumer by looking at the whole diamond story and impact from mine to retail. Maybe our guests today don't know that this campaign that you showed us, beside being the first from NDC, was aired for the first time on September 20th during the Emmy Awards in the US. And this generic campaign aims to focus on the moments and the relationship that diamond represents. And the key words here being moments and relationship, which leads me, David, to my first question to you. Can you tell us how does the modern consumer look like and what values drive their purchase of the diamond jewelry?
Yeah, the modern consumer is very complex. So I'll give you a relatively short answer compared with the more complex one. And that is because there are so many values that inspire him and her. And we look at it as a funnel. So at the very top of the funnel, it's how are we inspiring her? How are we making her fall in love with the diamond dream? Pre-pandemic, she had a lot more choices. He and she were spending a lot of money on travel, on experiences. They're about living life and about what life means for them. But it's also about goods. It's about technology. Whoever thought that a phone would be a competitor to diamonds and diamond jewelry? But an iPhone now can be over $1,000, and it's a desirable luxury product. So he and she have got a lot of choices on to how to spend their discretionary expenditure. And so at the top end of the funnel, it's about the dream. That, asking her, showing her what diamonds represent and about the dream. As she then goes through that funnel, and she and he go through that funnel, they want to know about the values of what you stand for in the world. And is that purchase doing good in the world? And that is why it's our job to share the work done in our industry, to show exactly the work that is being done, that the investment in the diamond is not only satisfying him and her, it's also bringing so much good to the world. And that's a message that still most consumers don't know about. And it's challenging to bring it. She's bombarded with messages from so many other areas. From so many different platforms, but it's very important that as they go through that purchase funnel to look at making a purchase, that the values of what we stand for the integrity of entrust, of sustainability, of development in the world. All of those things are part of the overall story that we tell. And again, I came from the fashion background, as an industry, we are a long way ahead of the fashion industry in terms of what we do. And up until now, we haven't had the platform to tell those stories properly. And it's our role as the Natural Diamond Council to work with retailers, with press, with editors, with ultimately the end consumer, to be able to tell those stories.
Thank you very much, David. So what can we, the KP, do? How can we help the NDC to communicate effectively, just like you said, to consumers and create that very needed desirability for natural diamonds?
Continue to strengthen the work that we do. And it's both an opportunity and a risk in everything that we do. We are an industry, we're not individuals. So whereas we all represent different organizations, different companies, different bodies, etc., the reputation of our industry is a collective reputation. And the positive work that we do goes to enhance all of our businesses collectively. And the more work that we do around sustainability, around ethics, around values, around really demonstrating what we do there, and the good that it brings to the world. So those are all positives, but I would also say, make sure there are no risks, because the risks are also there, that it only takes one operator in our industry not to be applying those ethics and values, and for a journalist or for a blogger or someone to pick those up, and that is hugely damaging for us. So it's a double-edged sword. We have to, as an industry, put the values and ethics of what we do at the core and center of everything that we do. It's not second to profit. It's how we are how we create profit in a way that is ethically and sustainably strong. So that's what I call on everyone to do. And again, I think the work that is being done, and thanks in a large part to the work of the Kimberley Process and the WDC, I think it's incredible what you've all achieved. And everyone should be very proud of that. But there's still a long, long way to go. And we can't ever stop and take for granted the work that we're doing, because eyes and ears are everywhere. And we have to just make sure that we are pushing to be the best that we possibly can as a total industry, in building the values of sustainability and social good.
Thank you very much, David. Edward, may I turn to you now? In the view of what you just heard from David, and also recalling what you said during your opening remarks, what do you think the WDC should discuss with governments, and to what purpose?
Thank you. I find David's story very inspiring. What is it all about is the connection between the research from the NDC, the connection between what the consumer wants on the one side, and how we translate it in the KP and in the producing countries, because those two are very closely connected. It is not as in the past. Nowadays, the young consumer demands the integrity of the whole value chain, from the mine to everybody who is involved. And I think it is great that the research now proves so much that these consumers are different and that they demand from the product the total integrity. And we have to be able to prove the sustainability. And one of the things that we very much support is those seven principles that I named before. Because with those principles, if we are sure that they are applied correctly in the whole chain, and then we can prove the integrity of the product. From our side at the WDC, we introduce early next year the system of warranties, on which we have worked for a long time, which will help all the players in the diamond and jewelry industry to make sure that they can do in the correct way their due diligence to get to this, what we are looking for, the application and the guarantee for the consumer of these principles. And for that, we have on our side also the system of warranties. And I remember many years ago that we had a marketing man at one of the diamond conference, and he had a very nice question about this. He said, you know, when you Apple introduces a new product, you see those long lines around the block for people in the morning at 6 or 5 o'clock in the morning, waiting till the store opens. Have you ever seen that at the jewelry store? Well, that's what we strive for, to get the consumer so excited about our product, but also so confident in our product that they will queue for our stores. And that's what we are trying to do.
Edward, I can't promise that. You set very high expectations, but I will do my best.
Thank you, David. And Edward, can I also ask you, how do you see the role of civil society in this?
Well, you know, the whole discussion about conflict diamonds, but the absence of conflict diamonds in the supply chain, as we try to guarantee that with the Kimberley process, is not enough. Today, the research proves that customers are asking for more. They are asking for ethically sourced diamonds in the whole chain. And it makes it the big difference between now and 5 years ago, or more than that even. We can cooperate with the NGOs to find out where and how there are violations, and we can bring the perpetrators to justice. Not the countries, because that would harm the total population, but the individuals or the companies that are involved. So in the early days of the KP, it was only about conflict diamonds, and today the scope is much wider. And in that we can cooperate with the NGOs.
Thank you very much, Edward. I see that one of our guests sent us a question, and it's one for you, Edward. Our guest is asking, why is it taking so long for the KP to expand the definition of conflict diamonds?
Well, for two reasons. Number one, the KP consists these days of 82 governments. And to get 82 governments aligned is not an easy task. My predecessor, Stefan Fiesler, he spent 3.5 years trying to do that. He was almost there, and I intend to continue his work, but it is not an easy task. Secondly, the KP works on the veto system, and that means that all governments must agree. And there in the past, we have stumbled upon some roadblocks that if they are not insurmountable, because on the strength of our argument, we continue to get the governments aligned. But also, the governments are not aligned and we do not expand the definition itself, we will strongly work on the 7 principles. But also we will see if we can support our own members in the local operations that they do, where they try to educate, for instance, the artisanal small miners and get to teach them about the values and help them in getting a better life. And some of the companies and some of our members are involved in that. And it is my intention to see how we can strongly support that in the future.
Thank you very much, Edward. I have now another question, and I will turn to David. One of our guests is asking if the NDC has agents on the ground, especially at mine site, to see if there are any human rights abuses or if they are respected.
Yeah, we don't. Our role is really as a marketing agency. Our expertise is about consumer demand, consumer messaging. So myself, all of our team, that's our expertise. We are not experts in anything to do with the functioning of anything in the supply chain. It's also the fact that there are a lot of other great industry bodies that are doing just that. So people like the RJC, that is it. That's their. They have the expertise to be able to audit and ensure that that people throughout the supply chain are fulfilling the ethics and the values of what we stand for. So we partner very closely with the RJC. You know, because that is their expertise. So we don't, our mission is not to get involved in and check and audit anything in the supply chain. We rely on other parts of other groups within the industry to do that. And then we celebrate those that are compliant with those organizations.
Thank you very much, David, which I guess you just answered, you know, the other question that we received from another guest was asking if NDC has any plans to deal with potential negative impacts that are still ongoing.
No, I mean, really the same thing is that we work with the other industry bodies to try and, I mean, for us, what's really important is to celebrate the good that's done. And then work with the other industry bodies to identify and try and get everyone to move to be value and ethic driven, and to really celebrate those and to make sure that it's good business sense to have the ethics. It's like in any industry, if it makes good business sense not to be ethical, then unfortunately there will be some players that aren't that. So what we've got to make sure is that we turn it into good business sense, and then everyone will want to, over and above whether they feel it's right or not, they will want to be there. So it's why we only work with partners that are that we know to share the values that we do. And you'll see more and more of that in terms of what we do. We'll be creating more and more partnerships within the industry. But we'll only be sharing those, we'll only be doing those partnerships and expanding our voice with partners that we know that share our values.
Thank you very much, David. Edward, may I ask you if you have any final remarks for our audience?
With pleasure. To add to what David Kellie just said about violations and about what the civil society is drawing our attention to. It is absolutely certain that we as a diamond industry will not remain idle when we find proof of violations of whatever aspect of the seven principles. But that does not mean that we will always do that publicly, because sometimes diplomacy and behind the scheme work does work better than naming and shaming. So you will have to have some confidence in the World Diamond Council that we will leave no stone unturned because we to do this, because this is the core of our objectives for the World Diamond Council is to get rid of these violations. At the end, it is very clear that the two of us cannot do without each other, because what the research is doing to push the sale of natural diamonds at retail level translate in what we are doing to make a clean and ethically sourced diamond chain from the source to the consumer. And that is the purpose of this webinar. And that is what we together are closely trying to work on. And for that, David, to come with the research to prove that this is exactly what the consumer wants is a very valuable contribution of the NDC to the work of the WDC and the KP. And with that, thank you very much.
Thank you, Edward.
Thank you all for listening.
David, I'm going to turn to you for one last question, please, if you don't mind. On your campaign, on the NDC campaign, a piece of jewelry is featured, and one of our guests is asking why did the NDC choose a piece that those stones were difficult to source, you know, and for a sensible price?
Yes. So, a couple of answers to that question. One is that what's really important for us is to celebrate innovation and newness. In any advertising, it's about what's going to inspire the consumer, not necessarily to buy that single piece, but inspire them to buy diamond jewelry, rather than showing here is the most volume pieces in there. And it's a good example is the cover of Vogue never has a white t-shirt on it, even though a white t-shirt is probably the most bought piece of fashion that's out there. So for us, it's about inspiring the consumer with the amazing innovation. I think because of one thing that we knew we weren't going to be able to achieve, which we will for the future, is that we, because of the time span that we had to create the campaign, I don't need to bore people with the details. We had a nightmare shooting that campaign at the height of the pandemic. But we weren't able to share with the industry in advance the jewelry that we were going to be shooting. And in the future, we would love to share with the industry, be more collaborative such that manufacturers, such that jewelry manufacturers, retailers have a sense of the jewelry that's going to be in the campaign that allow them to not necessarily buy that jewelry, but understand what the consumer is going to be inspired by and adapt for them. So kind of half mea culpa to say we just didn't, you know, the time span on everything this year has been crazy and we knew we weren't going to be able to do that. But on the other hand, I hope we will always be celebrating things that are innovative and new, as opposed to showing the consumer what they would typically expect to get from our industry. It's always a discussion that happens in any marketing world, should we advertise what we sell the most of, or advertise what we what is most going to inspire the consumer to buy into the category?
Thank you, David. And well, I have another one for you, David.
Okay, going.
So tell us, will the NDC help the industry protect itself against the ethical and ecological claims of the synthetic industry? That's a good one.
Yes, I know that was from an anonymous attendee as well. So I'm not sure who that came from. But yeah, I mean, when I joined this, I said at the very start that through the process of me joining the Natural Diamond Council, what was then the DPA, I felt all I can see is opportunity for this industry. I think, again, we don't have a lot of time today. There is massive opportunity for this industry ahead. There is, if we inspire the consumer in the way that I believe we can, if we get the right level of investments, if we have the right ethics in what we do, there are huge opportunities to grow this industry. And in order to do that, I don't need to be spending my time or the Natural Diamond Council time on worrying about the synthetic industry. So we are all about promoting the values of natural diamonds. That's our mission. There will be a place in the world somewhere for synthetics and lab grown. I can't predict where that will be. I can't predict what the price will be. But to be honest, I'm not interested in it. That's not my role. My role is to celebrate and promote and build the natural diamond world. If there are occasions when we believe that the integrity of the industry is being compromised because of work being done in the industry, whether it be done with synthetics and lab grown or anyone else, then we will work with other partners in the industry to, like the JVC and other partners as to how we ensure that all players in the industry are doing what is ethically right to support it. So it definitely isn't a focus for us. Our focus is natural diamonds and growing this industry. And if from time to time we feel that the integrity is being compromised, in what we do, then we will work with other bodies just to try and bring those players into line to make sure that no one in our industry is compromising our total industry.
Thank you very much. And I think you're done, David. Would you have, let's see, but anyway, would you have any final words for our audience, the KP family and the WDC members?
Just to say again, thank you very much for having me. It's great to speak with this audience and to take your questions. I'm always available to anyone in the industry to answer questions and discuss the opportunities in this industry. So I've had, it's been almost a year. I've really enjoyed my time in the industry. I think the people are amazing. They really inspire me to do the work that I think we can do. And I thank you all for all of your support. And I say, I can see great times ahead if we get things right. So I thank you and everyone at WDC for your partnership.
Thank you very much, David. And we wish you nothing but the best in all that you do. And we will be here to collaborate in any way we can. Thank you very much. Thank you all. Please stay safe. And we will be back soon, hopefully.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Have a nice day.